So while we're waiting for Arlene, and I wanted to do this anyway, after our session last week, Jeff Newman, everybody knows Jeff, right?
Right.
Probably do now.
Well, Jeff and I go way back to the when he was doing policy in the House. But anyway, after last week's session, he said to me, you know, I have the Providence Journal reprint of the RISDIC report. And he said, do you want to borrow it? And so I have the paper copy, and like Jeff's, mine is all marked up. But this is the Providence Journal one, which then I photographed and put on the Dropbox. Somebody asked me before about the Dropbox, and at the end of the day, I'll explain as much as I can and hope we get it right. But since Jeff has to leave, I thought it would be worthwhile to have him share with you some of his early experience on the legislation to get the require Rhode Island credit unions to get federal credit union insurance. And maybe you just jump into that.
Sure. This would be 1985. I was working actually on over on the Senate side in the lieutenant.
Can you stand up and speak louder?
Sure. Well, if I stand up, I can't be on camera.
Just speak louder.
Just speak louder.
Which is fine with me, except Phil needs this recorded.
But if you have trouble, why don't you? There's an empty seat right up here, and you'll hear better.
Yeah. I will try to project as loud as I can. Can you hear me?
I can.
Okay.
And if anybody can't hear any place, just raise your hand. It won't show on video.
I was working over on the Senate side in the Lieutenant Governor's office at that time, in the policy office there, and the real concerns we had at that time were, we were concerned about what things we were hearing about RISDIC. It was certainly no secret that there were issues there, but the real issue was that there were catastrophic failures in Maryland and in Ohio of private insurance. And this caused us to have a great deal of concern. And so we began to look at what the issues were there, and I had phone calls with the regulators in both Maryland and in Ohio about what kind of legislative action was taken in both Maryland and Ohio back in the early mid-80s as a way to try to beef up the insurance for these private insurance corporations that they'd had in Ohio and Maryland. And so we did draft up some legislation, and there were other people involved. They're not unknown to you, people like Frank Gashin and others. And we drew from information that had come out from various reports, and you'll hear right from the horse's mouth from Attorney General Violet in just a moment. But there was a lot of concern about what happened in other states. And I have to temper this comment by saying that while some people may have known just how severe and how critical things were in Rhode Island, not everybody did. We knew that there were issues, and we knew that this was something prospectively that needed to be done as soon as possible in Rhode Island to get either FDIC or it was the credit union, federal equivalent for credit unions, federal insurance. And so we did submit it, but we drafted up something, and I know that Frank Gashin was the person who eventually put it in on the House side to try to get federal insurance brought in for the credit unions. Again, nothing surprising, because you can almost quote the report, the RISDIC report verbatim, that there were going to be roadblocks. What we were not aware of was, we were aware that there would be roadblocks in the House, because there's a statement in the report that says that the House relied far too much on various information brought forth by Bob Bianchini, who at that time was the House Whip.
Yeah.
And Bob was considered at the State House, there's the go-to guy. You talk to him if you want to know about anything involving banks and credit unions.
But here's an important thing about Bob Bianchini that some of you know, and that is that he was the executive director of the Rhode Island Credit Union League,
right,
which was the trade association for all the credit unions.
Right.
And he passionately believed that this was a good system, the best possible system, And I have no question that he was sincere about that. He was wrong, but he was sincere. Go ahead, Jeff. I'm sorry.
So the statement in the report about him being the go-to guy, and pretty much the leadership pretty much went along with whatever he felt was the right thing to do. And as Phil says, he was a person who spoke with great passion about credit unions, great passion about what was going on at the time, and how everything was under control and things would be okay. And to the degree that people agreed with him, I don't know, because I wasn't privy to a lot of these meetings. But as a staffer who had to sort of help draft, I was not an attorney, so I didn't actually draft the legislation, but I had to provide the framework for the legislation based on what I had learned from Ohio and Maryland. It was going to be a rough road in the House. There's no question about that.
What we did not know
was how much opposition there was in the governor's office.
Did you talk to Bob Bergeron?
No.
You didn't? Okay.
Never had any conversations with him. I remember speaking with Frank Gashin. I read in here, and I was surprised that John D'Amico sponsored Bill on the Senate side, because John was kind of a lone wolf, very unusual person, and I just didn't recall that he was involved in this issue, but he obviously was.
So you drafted this legislation. Can you describe what you saw happen to it in 1984, 1985, 1986?
It's hard because it is a long time ago, but I would have to kind of go back through notes that I don't have anymore. But I don't recall on the Senate side whether there was a hearing, and very early on, the word came back that this bill probably wasn't going anywhere. Likely was not going anywhere. And the lieutenant governor's practice at that time was he periodically met with both John Revens on the Senate side, and he would go see Speaker Smith on the House side to try to move along various pieces of legislation. He had a very ambitious array of bills that had nothing to do with RISDIC. You know, things like daycare was a big issue at that time. Things like that, small business issues, environmental issues, and so forth. So he had a very big agenda, and basically people were telling him, you know, you're the lieutenant governor, there's a certain amount of your agenda that clearly has merit and will move, and then there's stuff that you don't have enough political capital to move everything along, and that's exactly what happened. But I think the part that was missing for us, because there was not a lot of communication between the lieutenant governor and the governor's office, in fact, the first three times the governor was out of state, Lieutenant Governor didn't even know he was acting governor. That eventually got remedied through a rather tense meeting. That got remedied eventually. But Brendan Daugherty, do you know who he is?
Yeah. Yes.
He was a trooper at the time. When he showed up at our door, we knew that the Lieutenant Governor was technically the person in charge. But Brendan was a terrific trooper. But anyway, as far as the RISDIC goes, I think where we were lacking was that we had no idea what was going on the executive side of things. And I think as the report says, if there had been if either the House or the governor had gotten behind this more seriously, I think there may have been a different outcome.
One of you sent me an email yesterday, I don't know who it was, but commenting that this was pretty depressing stuff to read.
Yeah.
And it is.
Yeah.
And yet, even at that, this report, you see Jeff Tights on the cover, and Jeff was the chair of the House Judiciary Committee. And I think he did an honorable job of trying to work through the stuff, and with Alan Barron and John Neils there, he was much more likely to do it well. And I think that raises questions that we may want to ask later about 38 studios and what kind of oversight or what kind of investigation is possible if lawyers for the House or the Senate would be involved in oversight hearings. And I think that's a tough question that we may want to come back to later in this session. But this report, as I read it, is damning in a lot of ways, but mild in its statement. You could be harsher in your expression of that. Jeff, while we have a minute, would you describe what you remember happening in terms of the actual legislation being before the Senate and the House in 1985, 86.
I remember that Frank Gashin, sitting on that House floor, he was not the most popular person.
That's understatement.
I don't know if the Attorney General is here.
Is she here?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, good. I didn't realize you were here.
Yes, I didn't want that's to good. Well, take up too much of her time.
I didn't see her come in.
Yes, that's what I want you to know.
So what's it? Good. We'll tie this up. So you remember the bill going down?
It wasn't even a question of going down. It was a question of, again, it was a question of whether it was ever going to get up. That's right. And I do remember that. And I do remember that people were throwing their lot in, that they felt that, you know, if Representative Bianchini felt that the bill was not necessary, that this was going to put a lot of undue stress on the credit unions, and that it might cause panic and cause problems, and that this was not the right time for this, they went along with that.
I think this is a perfect place to bring a real hero of this effort, Arlene Violet, who was Attorney General at the time, to sit with us. So Arlene.
Good morning. How are you? Hi, Jeff. I didn't mean to preempt you.
No. You're supposed to be.
I feel that way about you.
Get that water.
Thank you.
In case she wants a
good morning. How are you?
I want to say a word of introduction first, and I had more of an introduction ready than I'm going to be able to give now. But Arlene Violet, as everybody is aware, was Attorney General, and I would recommend her first book called Convictions, subtitle My Journey from the Convent to the Courtroom. I would recommend it highly to you. I used it in writing this book and was glad for it. She also, some of you may not be aware of this, did a wonderful production called The Family that was at Trinity Rep. And we hope
right.
we go to
that's
Broadway.
Right.
Has not yet, but... and then she has a wonderful book that she wrote with John Partington about the beginning of the witness protection program and his role in that. And that's a whole other conversation that's really worth having. I'm going to leave it at that. I had some good quotes from the book about that would get a good reaction from people. But I think since in light of time, let's jump right in. And if you would be willing to pick up where Jeff left off in terms of what you saw happening. And let me put the question to you this way to start it. You brought in Bob Stitt and Charles Black she was elected in 1984 as Attorney General, the first female Attorney General in the United States. And after her election, very quickly started this investigation of the RISDIC credit unions and other thrift institutions. And maybe you'd start by telling us what prompted you to do that and your decision to to employ Robert Stitt for $1 a year. That was a bargain. But let's jump into that.
Yeah, and Charlie Black, of course, was on loan from the Division of Taxation, so he did not cost us anything. Yeah, well, while I was elected in 84, I didn't take office until January of 85. And about 2 days after being in an office, I went to the Bank Board of Incorporation meeting, which was held at the Department of Business Regulation. So I showed up, and they said, this is the first time an attorney general has come to this meeting. I said, well, I'm supposed to be on this board, right, ex officio? Yeah, but you don't really have to come. I was told you don't really have to come because, you know, it's just all boring routine matters. So I said, well, I'm here, so let's sit down and let's start the meeting. So the meeting then had Marquette Credit Union and Woonsocket, et cetera. And the kinds of stuff they were doing was allowing them to raise how much money they could loan, et cetera. And I had looked at the material. Actually, I had arrived a half hour earlier because they didn't even send me an agenda. I just knew I was supposed to be there. So I arrived and I looked at the background documents, and I was noticing that on the loans, they were all going to politically connected people. And by that, that definition is the people who contribute to the politicians, like Anton Giordano, D'Ambra. All these politically connected people would go in and they would get millions of dollars from these credit unions, and they never had to personally sign for the loan. Their corporation only was responsible for the loan, so that if for whatever reason the project went belly up, all they would do is walk away without any of their money at risk, reincorporate under a completely different name, and then go back for more money. So like Anton Giordano probably had like 14 corporations by that time that he would go to various personal credit unions, including, you know, the place over here on Hillside.
Yes.
So he would get all these loans, but never having to sign on the dotted line, okay? So while we were at the meeting...
I just want to break in for a second. And those corporations whose membership were often... not easily discernible to the public.
That's right.
Were making contributions. At one point, it became Russ Garland from the Providence Journal uncovered the fact that a couple of people had used 11 different corporations to max out their contributions to Ed DiPrete. And so Arlene has already mentioned that, or Jeff mentioned, that you didn't have action from either side. You didn't have either the legislative or the executive branch taking action, and you begin to see why.
Right. Well, for the first three meetings, the votes were 4-1, because I was always the one opposing what was going on. So they really loved me right off the bat. But I just knew it was wrong, and Mr. Stitt had moved from being a New York banker, attorney, into East Greenwich, Rhode Island, and I asked Gary Clark at the Division of Taxation to loan me Charlie Black, because my thesis is that you catch people with the pencil that are doing white-collar crime, right? So I wanted two guys who were proficient in financial crime. So they got into the office. I gave them all my data from the first three meetings. And I said, I'm not going to tell you what I think. Just tell me what you think. And they said, wow, this is a real problem. So we selected four credit unions at that time, and every one of them had insufficient capital. I mean, they were loaning money out, and everybody they loaned millions of dollars out, there was a direct correlation with campaign contributions to the governor and to the lead people in the Senate and the people in the House that were the leaders, and the mayors in Woonsocket, et cetera. It was like a network. So we said, wow, you know, they're totally undercapitalized. If they keep going like this, all the little guys are going to lose their money at that credit union. So we then, Liz Moranzi and Frank Ash, and Liz Moranzi was a nun, by the way, and was in the General Assembly for many years. She was a persona non grata also. So I guess the two of us were like none such. But I just made that up. But we looked at it, and obviously we thought there was a serious problem. So we contacted, Matt Smith was the Speaker of the House, so we contacted him, and we contacted the Senate, but the House we knew was really where the problem was going to be, right, Jeff? And of course, the governor. And
they had written this report for you.
Yes, and we brought the report.
We call now the Stitt report. Go ahead.
Right. So we brought the report to them and briefed them. It was actually Charlie as well as Bob Stitt and me, and told them that there was an extraordinarily incredible problem on the horizon. They had to get this under control and get the federal insurance. And that was the only way to solve this, or else there was going to be problems, etc. So Norman Benoit, who was a lawyer for Ed DiPrete, was charged with looking into whether we were right or not. He was with a big law firm at the time, and I guess he ultimately determined that our facts were all correct. And he got back fast, and he told Governor DiPrete that you should really be supporting this legislation. So to answer your question, I mean, I've been in places where I knew I wasn't welcome, but the House meeting was just absolutely incredible. They had a meeting ahead of time at the Aurora Club, And Liz Moranzi, who was a state representative, tried to get into the Aurora Club because she knew they were plotting about how to blast me out of the water when I was appearing the next day. And they told her she couldn't go in because she was not an Aurora Club member. You know, now, nowadays, those kinds of meetings would violate the Open Meetings Act because they were actually caucusing on how they were going to defeat this. But in retrospect, let me say this.
It was Peter Navolva, the president of RISDIC, Bob Bianchini, the head of Rhode Island Credit Union League and vice chair of the Finance Committee, hosting the meeting at the Aurora Club. And actually, there were two dinners at the Aurora Club. So you begin to see the momentum building to block this legislation.
Yeah, and you know, basically, you know, I'm more cynical than Phil, okay, about this, because number one, there was no way this legislation was going to pass, because these banks were the credit unions were the piggy banks for these people who had no business doing what they were doing on other people's money. Because remember now, they're loaning the credit union money of the little baby depositors that have those accounts, right? That's really whose money ultimately, as proven, was at risk. So they were making these loans to the political network. That's really what it was all about. And there was no way on God's green earth that this was ever going to pass, number one. Number two, I know they knew what the condition was, because even at the public hearing, well, we had been warned to be careful about what we said, because people knew how shaky those credit unions were. What happened in 1990 would have happened in 95, 96, 97, 85, 86, 87, because people would say, oh my God, you know. So we had to be very careful. I remember meeting with Mr. Goodrich, who was head of the in Projo, who was business editor at the time, and said to him, you know, we can't do a story about this, but you know, if I get booted out of office, I want you to know what the condition is, because I don't really see the politicians doing anything about this bill. This is an extremely serious issue, and it's got to be handled well so there's not a run on the banks. So we go to the hearing, and you know, Bob Stitt, who's a perfect gentleman, was Charlie was there also, but I don't remember him speaking, but Mr. Stitt was a perfect gentleman. Never raised his voice. You know, they were like beating up on him like he was wearing a dunce cap. Of course, you know, they were playing, you know, what does an ex-nun know about anything about finances? You're just plain wrong. And it was really just a beat-up fest, you know, at the thing. And I said, well, you know, there really is no problem. And I said, you all can move into executive session, which was legal. And I have copies here of the reports. Originally, Mr. Smith said Matthew Smith was going to pass them out to you. I don't know if he did or he didn't. Did he? And they were just blanked. They didn't answer one way or the other. I said, well, I all have your copies here. Why don't you take a recess and read it and then come back? And they said, no, they wouldn't do it. So they go off. And the other reason I knew, you know, that other than the political business, that why it wasn't going to pass, is that if the governor doesn't show up and testify on a bill back in those days, right, Jeff? It was dead. The only way the legislature, they have signals, and if the executive doesn't show up on what theoretically has executive support, it means it's low on my priorities. So Ed DiPrete was nowhere to be found. I guess he was counting his cash from the Cranston Land deal. No, that hadn't happened. But in any event, it didn't happen. You know, we tried twice, and then, ironically, Bob Stitt and I worked out of an office over here with where Tom Perlman was at the end of Blackstone Boulevard. So even in 1987, we did an update on the report, because he still had some more material that was another credit union that was in trouble, and we put that together. And we sent it in, again, to the top honchos, not the lieutenant governor, but the governor. In a way, the lieutenant governor was almost irrelevant, and I don't mean that negatively, but in the political system, that was true, because Ed DiPrete could veto any bill, even if it got passed. So we went back to the honchos again and said, you know, there's five. We haven't had time to study the others. And as you learn, there was really nine that were a problem. We had gotten to five of them at the time, but they didn't do anything about it. And any one of them was a tinderbox that would set the whole system.
And the point here is that Ed DiPrete received five discrete warnings from Arlene and Bob Stitt, from Norman Benoit, who reviewed that report and affirmed it, from Jack Partridge, who was a strong supporter of his, from the two of the Federal Reserve people from Boston came down, literally drove down from Boston to the State House and tried to convince him that he had to do something about this before it all collapsed. Yeah. And there's a fifth one that I'm blanking on, right? Yeah. Anyway, there were five distinct, clear, explicit warnings that the governor did not act on. Now, you can say, did he know? Well, he knew. Why didn't he act? Well, Arlene's already made the observation, which you're aware of, that he was taking so much money in campaign contributions from RISDIC institutions, which was legal in that time, and from officers of RISDIC institutions. He was just taking the money, and his campaigns were increasingly expensive. In 1988, set all records for Rhode Island. 1990 doubled those records in his campaign against Bruce Sumlin. So he was taking money hand over fist. I mentioned Mike Smith in the book, who had worked as DiPrete speechwriter and in policy, and later he came to Common Cause. He said he was doing penance. But I said to him, so how did you, and he had not known anything about this theory of contracts, which was a whole separate issue from RISDIC, but I said, how did you, help me understand how he could avoid the campaign finance stuff, and he said, every time I would write something like that into a speech, it would come back crossed out.
Yeah.
And it was only in September of 1990, when the die was already cast in terms of his final defeat, that he then said he was going to push for campaign finance. Mm-hmm. I interrupted you.
No. And the culture of the General Assembly, and I think it's true today, and I heard you mention 38 Studios when we came in, it really is a, you know, go along to get along culture. Yeah. And none of that has really changed. You know, the people who said they were duped, et cetera, maybe they didn't know the facts, but they don't choose to know the facts.
Yes. Right.
Because the whole idea is, I want, you know, my little league to get this legislative grant. I want this, I want that. And if I fall into disfavor with the top honcho, the Speaker of the House or the Senate President, I'm not going to get my money. So it's yes, sir, no, sir, reporting for duty, sir. Whatever they want, that's it, and it gets done. And that was exactly the culture back then. The people in that General Assembly, were they bad guys, bad gals? No, not really. But even to this day, I don't see the General Assembly really doing their jobs because they still have the go along, to get along kind of mentality there. And that's why we continue to have the type of outbursts that we have with the 38 studios, et cetera. I just want to say one thing, because I got to get it off my chest. I was just writing my column for next week, you know. And I was saying to myself, all the time we're being told that we don't have enough money for this, social services, we don't have enough money for DOT, et cetera. Well, over the same period of time that Governor Raimondo wants to borrow that money, et cetera, we've already spent that money on the roads. So the issue, though, isn't that we don't have enough money and we need more. The issue is we don't do the right thing with the money we have. The problem on our roads, okay, is that the road contractors run the state and they run the Department of Transportation. Or maybe LBD and Governor Raimondo are going to change that. But they dictate to them. Everything's always a cost overrun. They use materials that are insufficient. You know, it's the planned obsolescence, you know, that Marsha McLuhan and other people warned us about. That the minute the road is put down, there's going to be cost overruns, the material is going to be junk, and it's going to break up, and then they're going to get the contract to repair it. And how about the I-195 bridge?
Yeah,
example, right?
Railings.
Exactly. Tens of millions of dollars, hundreds of millions of dollars beyond what it's supposed to cost, and it's unsafe.
Right.
And even while it was being built, they had chunks of concrete falling into the Providence River. And they didn't find Cardi. They just said, well, you know, they didn't make them redo it. In Quonset, on 401, that was constructed so poorly that the federal government wouldn't give their 85% in. We had to pick up the entire tab for it because the joists and the PSI, it's called, in terms of the weight load, they thought, obviously, that it would be heavier trucks, because the whole thing is designed, right, to be heavy commercial down at Quonset Point. The feds wouldn't sign off on it. We're not going to pay you. And the load is still a problem over there. That's another problem waiting to happen. And nobody enforces it. So all the stuff we're reading now, whether it's about DOT, et cetera, it just drives me crazy, frankly, because it's about how we spend the money we have. And unless we change the culture of planned obsolescence, we just keep throwing good money after bad, after bad, after bad, after bad, because the roads are junk. You go up to New Hampshire, they have infinitely more snow than we have, but they have the right concrete that they use on the road to start with. It's not like a pit stop. You know, nobody goes like this riding in New Hampshire. But over here on the east side, it's like they have a lunch.
Oh.
You know, it's like it's this part of the state. It's ridiculous. And, you know, so actually, you know, that's what my column is. And this week's column that just came out, I did like the Hogan's Heroes thing with Clink and Sergeant Schultz, I know nothing, you know, and Clink. And I just took various episodes from Hogan's Heroes and the dialogue from it. Of course, I pinned it to people in Rhode Island. Nobody knows nothing after the disaster. Nobody knew anything about RISDIC. Nobody knows anything about 38 Studios. Or we don't know who to blame about the bad roads and the 195. We're still studying what went wrong. And they're charging us, by the way, $8,000 a month to keep up those barriers, you know. So they put the barriers up because the bridge
is unsafe.
You know, the trucks can go toppling into the Providence River, and then they have the nerve to charge us on the barriers. But what they built was unsafe to start with. Now, that's the definition of madness. And people like us, you know, we're just like regular citizens in a way. We're not in office now, or we're just regular citizens. We just have to keep paying and paying and paying. But the people up in the General Assembly, don't tell me they don't know this stuff. Of course they do, and they should make it their business to know this stuff. But we have such low expectations, frankly, of our elected officials. We let them get away with murder. Amen.
Thank you.
Let's go back to 1986. Here you are in the spring of 1986 trying to get this federal credit union insurance legislation passed, and it's killed in both the House and the Senate.
Yes.
Your campaign for re-election, I haven't asked you this question before. They always say don't ask a question unless you already know the answer. So I don't know the answer, but let me...
They really say never come to a gathering where you're going to get surprise questions. That's the real answer. Only kidding.
tell us a little bit about that election in the fall of 1986 when they knocked you off.
Yeah. Well, part of it's my fault, for sure. We had son of a former Democrat attorney general, and I gave him a chance. I think he wanted to win this Gilbane case so badly that he had made up evidence in the case. The trial was the first day of the trial. An issue came up about the status of this Mr. Cruz, who was a minority contractor, and that he really wasn't a minority contractor. What they used to do back in those days is, in order to get monies for projects, you had to give certain amounts to minorities.
Yeah.
And at that time, minority was a black minority. Now women also qualify as a minority, right, in the contracting business, but I don't believe back then they did. So Cruz had written statements of what he was testifying to and how Gilbane had told him, stay home, you don't have to do anything. We'll give you a piece of what, you know, you would have gotten had you really been doing the work, blah, 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 blah. So Cruz takes the stand and he slightly changes his statement. And at lunchtime or there around that time, I call in I call the woman in who was the stenographer that had taken the statement, and she says to me, the prosecutor asked me to change the statement to make it more damning.
Oh, oh my God.
So I said, what was it? And she told me what it was, and it was not as damning of Gilbane as he initially did. Now, the fact, I don't know what the facts ultimately were in that case, but, I mean, he could have been, you know, when you first sit down with the suspect, I say, did you do this? And you say, I wasn't there. I don't know anything about it. And so you go through a whole process where you do have suspects that go on for about an hour before they get at the truth. So Cruz might have been just warming up to what ultimately was the truth, which was his last statement. But there was certainly a statement that I viewed as exculpatory, which was the first thing that he said. And I thought it was significant enough, so I went to court at 2 o'clock and dismissed the case. Without anybody making a motion, I went in and said, Your Honor, I want to be heard. This evidence has come up, and I think if it was not passed over in time, the case should be dismissed. So that certainly hurt me. And D'Ambra, who was one of the companies that used to give campaign contributions, they were found guilty of on the Jersey barriers under my administration. They would put one coat of paint on, but they billed for two coats of paint, which was what the contract was. And so they made $86,000 on a mile stretch on 95 by only putting one coat of paint on it. And so we moved to convict them and were successful on the fact that they had picked up $86,000 under false pretenses because there was only one paint. And I was beginning to look into DOT as a real major focus. I mean, there's so much to do. There was RIMFIC going on then, too. Remember RIMFIC? Yes. Where, you know, Judge Fay didn't make enough money as a judge. They were all getting low-income loans, and that's a whole other story. But we had a lot on our plate.
Yeah.
So, in any event, Sunday before the election, D'Ambra actually put an ad in, like they never had been convicted, saying that I was terrible and I was a bad person and I was prosecuting people that were innocent. And they named themselves in the ad, which made me surprised that the Journal Bulletin actually printed it when they'd done the story that they were convicted. But I think all of that, conspired. But, for me, I never ran anyway. I mean, the first time I ran to raise the issues of office. As you all know, most of you know, I was a Sister of Mercy, and that order I belonged to, the Sisters of Mercy, were an activist order, and our whole purpose was to respond to the unmet need. So in Rhode Island, I was a lawyer as a nun. I have done public interest law all my life, both before and after being AG, and I went to my religious superiors and said, I think I know what unmet need. The victims have no rights in Rhode Island. They show up three times, and the third time they say, well, you didn't really have to come. We already disposed of that case. So they wouldn't have any input, any anything. So I wanted to do something about victims' rights. Raymond Patriarca at the time ran his, his empire out of Federal Hill, nothing, not touched, etc. Talk about payoffs and the corruption in the state. And so I said, I think my superior said, oh, okay, go ahead, run. So when I first ran, I just wanted to raise the issues. I never thought, I'd get in the 40s on the vote. But I had the benefit of low expectation, because if you're a nun and you can walk and talk at the same time, that's a big deal. No one expects that. You really don't.
So the quote I was going to read to you from Arlene's book and the book to questions was being called in by Bishop Gelinow.
Oh, yeah.
And maybe you just share that and then what's
yeah,
the questions?
Yeah. Well, Bishop Gelinow first thought I was running for Secretary of State. And he told me I'd make a good Secretary of State. I said, oh, no, I'm running for Attorney General. And that's when he changed his mind and told me I would have to leave if I won. But to me, it was a choice between the reality of the commitment of being a Sister of Mercy and the commitment, or just keeping the title of it and then walking away from the reality. I'll tell you one thing. The first day, I told you what I did on the second day in my office. On the first day, there was a closet that I finally found the key for and opened up. And in that closet was a file on a priest who was driving in Narragansett, Rhode Island, and he ran over someone and killed them. And he was drunk. And as you all know, the lawyers in the room know that if you let somebody plead to a lesser included offense, double jeopardy attaches, right? So they let him plead to this innocuous thing about crossing the yellow line or something like that. But the family never knew that he had done that. And there was like 5 days left before the statute of limitations would run for suing civilly. And I called the family in and said, you've got 4 days, please come in. They said, I wonder what she wants. They came in, I gave them the facts to sue. for the death of, the kid was out jogging, he was like a 21-year-old URI student, unsolved crime, except it was this priest. And we did the first sex prosecutions against priests in my office.
Good.
We were number two in the country. Louisiana went first, and we did four prosecutions of priests. So I somehow think that, you know, that might have been tied into it a little bit, too, because going back to the days of Bishop McVinney, you're too young to know this, Bishop McVinney, but politicians who were Catholics had to go to him and ask permission. To run for office. And he'd say, it's not your turn yet, it's this other guy. They were all Irish, Jeff, I want you to know.
let's see if we got some questions from the class.
This has nothing to do with what you've said, except to share something with you that you may not have known existed. I'm an older lawyer, so I can remember some of these names. I can recall appearing one time on a matter before a judge in federal court who was the former assistant U.S. attorney, Pastore's appointee, wonderful judge, and it was on an environmental matter.
Yes.
I happened to be in the courtroom. I represented an insurance company that was involved, and this young woman who was a sister of something or other, I didn't know at the time, and not wearing a habit, but wearing not quite a mini skirt, but something very appeared before the judge, who was a staunch Catholic, a member of the Knights of Columbus, with ties to the Vatican and so forth. And she appeared before him, holding her hands like this, and saying, "Sir, Your Honor," she didn't say senior, but she appeared very respectful. We didn't have a chance. It was our motion.
Go ahead.
Thank you, ma'am.
What you said sounds very familiar. How do you think, has anything changed?
No. He thinks so, right? No. He thinks things have gotten better. I just am astounded by the lack of courage, though. You know, when I started off my life, I always thought there would be infinitely more good people than bad people, but quite honestly, now I'm not so sure because of the greed, how people don't step up to the plate. Mm-hmm. So as I look politically, the 38 studios for me, you know, really was an example of exactly everything that happened in the RISDIC business and the RIMFIC. I mean, they go out of their way, you know, and today I'm sure you saw the newspaper article or yesterday that there were actually warnings, and then all the pillars of society, men that I have a lot of respect for, who are on that Economic Development Commission because of their expertise, and they would never spend their $75 million without, you know, without reading the reports.
That's right.
But they didn't have the slightest hesitation to commit our money. That money they wouldn't have spent personally if the decision was up to using their money. And I don't think much has changed. Regrettably,
Let me just respond to this quickly, because I think there have been changes, but they are not always prevailing. And one example, for instance, is what Gina Raimondo is doing with DCYF finally.
Yeah.
DCYF has been a total mess for 25 years. And under her leadership, Jamie McDonald and Lisa Hawley are now really working on reorganizing. We met with them a couple weeks ago. I think they're going to do the job. And we were finally starting to see some of the financial abuses there. The governor has to have more power, and that's been a problem from the beginning. Yeah. The governor now has a four-year term and can bring people in from out of state who will take over as head of agencies. They wouldn't have come for a two-year term. The governor now makes appointments to all the boards and commissions that were routinely always under legislative control before. I think that's beginning to make a difference, but it's not final. And meanwhile, the old culture of go along, get along is there. And I'll give you a quick example with relation to 38 Studios, that clearly the House and Senate leadership are determined, if there is any investigation by oversight committees, to go ahead and do it with in-house lawyers. Mm-hmm. And you know who the in-house lawyers are responsible to. Mm-hmm. So there is an effort to really keep the lid on, and so all the calls for an independent investigation, obviously a lot of facts have been assembled in distilled or there in terms of depositions and emails and so on. But what do you do to distill those, to figure out what they all mean, to test the veracity of those witnesses? That's what we have to do now, and that's why we again need an independent prosecutor. In 1991, after the RISDIC collapse, the Senate had set up a panel, the House set up a panel, the Attorney General was going to do something but didn't have any money, and so we called, and it's in the book, we called for outside independent investigators, and that's when Bruce Sondland got everybody in the same room and said, we're going to do an independent investigation, and we're going to bring in some people from outside the state. They brought in John Neils and Alan Barron, and they did a credible investigation. Some of us think they might have gotten some more stuff than they actually got, but they got a lot.
Yeah, and I was surprised, though, that neither of them interviewed me initially, and Vatan Gregorian didn't.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's a reason, in my view, why some... Not that, you know, I don't consider myself central to anything, but I did have some facts about it, neither of those bodies. But to go back to DCIF, that's my example of we need more money to take care of kids. You know, $950,000, like today's headline, where did it go?
Yeah.
What happened? They never give $450,000 back, then they get a pay increase the next year. And so the money's all there, it's just that it's mismanaged. And, you know, I've got great confidence and hope, I guess, that Gina Raimondo will do something about it. But it, with all due respect, when Ms. McDonald said, well, we're going to bring these services back inside and it's going to save money, well, the reporter asks the next question. The next question is, oh, does that mean you're going to be hiring state employees? Meaning the packages that come with that. And the answer is, well, it's possible. Well, to me, you cannot make a comment that you're going to save money unless you already know that other piece of the action. And what is it going to cost you to bring it in? Because initially, they were all outsourced because it was costing too much money with state employees doing it in-house. So, like, the circle just keeps going around and around. And I'm hopeful, and she's making all the right moves, but the jury is still out, in my view.
And the pressure is clearly still on, from the, particularly the House leadership, but also the Senate leadership. Let's take another question.
If I'm not mistaken, it wasn't until 1990 with Iron's case that the Supreme Court said legislators were not ruled by the Ethics Commission.
2009 was the Irons decision.
Yeah.
Well, when was the Supreme Court decision?
That was 2009.
2009.
May of 2009.
Okay, so why wasn't Bianchini brought before the Ethics Commission?
He was. He was brought before the old Conflict of Interest Commission on a complaint by Bob Bergeron, who was the head of Woodlawn Credit Union. And under the law at that time, there were 9 members of the commission, and they needed to have 5 affirmative votes to find a violation.
Right.
And they got several people recused. One of the people who was on the commission was Michael Morey, who was the head of the Warwick Municipal Employees Credit Union, and he voted against finding violation. So they had 4. So technically, Bianchini was not found in violation, but it was only on a technicality. He went out and he said, I never meant to violate anything and I didn't violate anything. And clearly he you know, I interviewed Bob for the book several times and he's a nice guy, but he clearly is wrong. Again, sorry, I didn't need to run away on that one, but let's take the question back.
Yeah, I'm not savvy in terms of finance. If the FDIC had come in and the banks were already over their heads, what would have happened?
Well, they would have guaranteed at that time up to $100,000 of
the
creditors.
Even though they came in after the fact, the banks were already...
Right, you're in for a dime, you're in for a dollar. And by the way, though, the remediation, the whole purpose of that FDIC system or any federal system that backs these institutions is to take care of creditors. Now, we have forgotten that. I mean, it's all remediation. So the only reason why that insurance exists to start with is it's our protection, right? We're so used to now the banks being protected in the last few years and getting bailed out, et cetera. We forget that the whole underpinning is to protect us. So yes, we would have had a federal source to pay off. Now, the RISDIC system, they didn't have any money, and they had a little bit of a backup with the national NCUA, but NCUA was undercapitalized as well. So we knew from the study that there was no way that people were going to have money there to back up their deposits. And, of course, we learned that for certain in 1990 when Bruce Sumlin had to close the credit unions and took an act of legislature to make people whole.
And I should say to this day, Bobby and Keeney truly, I think he truly believes that had Bruce Sumlin not declared a bank holiday and closed the credit unions, that the system could have been saved.
Bruce Sumlin did the only possible action. He was a hero of this action. And I really find it, I know, you know, it's ludicrous that the person who causes the problem is the person who says Bruce Sumlin is to blame. Bruce Sumlin was the solution. Keeney and his cohort were the problem, not the other way around.
Go ahead.
Because the credit unions were in such bad state, would the federal government, the FIDC equivalent, have actually come through with the guarantee?
Yes, because that, you know, back in the 80s and our, you know, in the, those pristine days, all that credit insurance was for our protection. And they had done that. Remember, what was that savings and loan? One of the Bushes was involved in it, right, in Florida. They had gone in and, you know, they bailed out, et cetera. So, yeah, there was precedent because the whole legislation was not to have the hardships that people ended up having in Rhode Island with closed businesses, et cetera. And by the way, not all the credit unions were bad. He mentioned Bob Bergeron at Woodlawn. That's the problem. The bad guys, you know, and they brought down the good guys, too, because even though those good guys didn't end up having to close, you know, everybody had a jaundiced eye toward them. Oh, I wonder if, you know, if I put my money in there, that's going to go the same way. So everybody suffered that was a credit union in the state, even the good guys.
One more question.
Me?
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm just wondering, in the book, I think it was 5 years before the collapse that you did this report. And then I think it was the, how do you say his name? Vartan Gregorian. You were criticized, that report, or that commission criticized you for not doing it early. Well, you tried. I mean, one part of it. And then last week we talked about whistleblowers. I mean, how could anybody blow a whistle? To whom do you blow the whistle? And how? You tried to make this report public. So why were they critical of you?
Well, first of all, I wish Vartan Gregorian or anybody on that commission had interviewed me, and they did not. Okay. Secondly, who do you go? You can't cause a bank run. So I went to, and I consider that we worked until 1997 because Stitt and I did an update even when I was out of office for the legislators that January and sent the fifth pot, you know, the fifth credit union information to them. So I thought we were still working on it until 97. So it was like 87. So there was like a 3-year hiatus. Thank you. And so, but from my perspective, that I went to Goodrich over at the Journal. Everybody knew it was a hot potato. They didn't want to run on the banks. And then just things, it was like banging your head against the wall. But I was disappointed they didn't, and I wrote a letter after a while when I saw that they weren't going to be interviewing. I wrote a letter while it was still going on, and I never got a response.
Wow.
Interesting, Arlene's comment that Bruce Sumlin did the right thing. And as you saw in the chapter about RISDIC, the public was really ignorant about all this. And then when it started to come out, they got angry at everybody. And the public often doesn't know who to where to focus the anger that they're feeling. They were outraged. They were coming into the State House. They were expressing the anger. But a lot of it got diverted onto Bruce Sumlin, I think, wrongly.
Exactly.
One last sort of naive question. Does it, when people really got angry, and they did, and right now got started, does it take this kind of total disaster to get people's attention? Because things are hidden pretty well. I mean,
regrettably, I think you're right. You know, it goes to the heart of government, though. You know, this summer, people, in every summer before, studio, you know, 38 studios, you should be able to go out and, you know, put a hot dog on the barbecue and not have to worry about what's going on in the state, because we elect all these public servants. and give them a salary, and you know, and we expect them to do the right thing. But it, to me, it's infuriating when these incidences happen, because actually we're mugged. We're being, with the Department of Transportation, we've been mugged for years by the poor quality of the roads, the lack of supervision, and they get away with murder. And then they get the job to repair what they didn't do right to start with. Now, how insane is that? And who's paying for it, right?
Yes,
all right here, right? And but it's a shame, because I think the public are victimized, and hopefully people in office will try to do something about it.
Let's take, boy, I've got two more.
Dave.
Now I see three. Let's try to do it quick.
I'll be short.
It's been said that if the people who represent us in the, as the reps in the Senate were paid, that perhaps we would get somebody better to serve because they don't have to have a job. What is your feeling on that?
Well, in some ways, I used to be opposed to it because I think that there are sufficient people of goodwill that would run for office. But the more I think about it, everything's gerrymandered toward lawyers and teachers
and
other groups. So I think if you did have, like, it's a full-time job, you'd probably get a better mix, because lawyers then couldn't give up their practice to do that. But then I'm afraid they'll then change the times. The sessions will be at like 7:30 at night every night, so that they can do their lawyer job and then go at night. So I'm not sure it's a total solution, but I don't know. I mean, you, in your religious tradition, certainly in mine, right, in yours even more so than probably my tradition, you give to the community, right? And so I don't understand why more people of goodwill just don't. And part of it is because the bad guys say, why do we want that toxic environment for ourselves to have to deal with them? So they win by, you know, by their toxic poisoning of the good guys.
And we'll
don't want to deal with them.
We'll come back to some of that. Let's just take a question and one more over here, and then we'll call it.
Okay.
This may be a naive question, but I just moved here 5 years ago from Chicago.
Oh, you're not naive then.
And, you know, the stories you tell have parallel stories in a different place. So it occurs to me to ask you, are there states that represent a better example of what government, how government should function?
Yeah. I don't know the answer to that. You know, people always say, are we better or are we worse than other states? For me, it doesn't matter. This is where I live, and this is where people that I love live, and we ought to have a better environment with all the money that we're spending. But I really don't know if there's, we're better or worse. I just know this is hard to live with what we have.
Where is there hope? The book makes, as someone said, and I would agree, makes you feel depressed. Mm-hmm. All that went on, but some good came of it. Now today you're saying, because we've had Studio 38, now there's a question of revolving door going on again.
Yeah.
And where is there hope, and what is it going to take? Another crisis and solution?
Well, regrettably, yes, unless people of goodwill speak up, as they did, you know, in my view, on the Poor Sox thing. As you know, they... When the Poor Sox were going to buy it, today's headline, right, it was going to be like $4.7 million, and it's really worth $17 million. Come on! Yeah. You know? Come on! I mean, and that stuff has got to stop. So, I wrote about 5 or 6 columns on the Poor Sox thing. Because why should we have to pay for billionaires who made their money off us to start with, right? It just aggravates me. It's not right. So, and the Chamber of Commerce, they're all coward. I've been very outspoken about them. Oh, they don't want to get bad, and it might hurt their business, etc. Well, you know what? Your business is being mugged. You just don't know it because of the taxes you're going to have to pay. Whether you're a trucking company or not, you're being mugged anyway. So for crying out loud, look yourself in the mirror when you get up in the morning and say, I'm proud to look at myself because I spoke out, as opposed to, ooh, I'm so scared. We're like a frightened population here.
Yeah.
So it's only going to change, and we won't need a crisis, and people of goodwill get up and speak out. But if they don't, then it's going to take another crisis.
Last question.
Sir?
wasn't a question. It was maybe an addition. I'm also a new resident of Rhode Island. I come from Massachusetts, which I've watched some corruption there. And actually, I'm originally from the state that invented corruption, New Jersey. I've been interested just as an observer. One of the problems that Rhode Island has is self-image, has a bad self-image. So are we the most corrupt? I mean, that's what everybody from Massachusetts would say. Why would you go down there? Well, they have these, I just Google it. There are five different places that say, what are the most corrupt states? In the East, we're not even mentioned.
Right. I think that's important.
Number one is Jersey. Number two, I believe, is Pennsylvania, where I lived. I'm sorry to say that. Number three.
Hey, you're not being a problem here, are you?
Number three was Maine.
Maine.
Yeah, it was Maine. Maine comes up over and over again. And most of the corruption doesn't come from the East. The most corrupt states are in the South.
Yeah.
The Deep South are, you know,
Louisiana, Edward
unbelievable. Edwards. Mississippi, Louisiana, et cetera, et cetera. So maybe there's some hope. I would guess that Vermont might be.
You have one final word for us, Arlene.
We need to speak up. You know, the fact is that day in and day out, even if they do the 1 cent on the gas tax, I mean, financially, can we afford a penny more on it?
Yes,
of course,
yes.
But that's not the point, is it? You know, and or it's like being stoned to death with marshmallows. It just keeps going on, and then all of a sudden we don't even feel that we're being stoned to death,
yeah.
And that's what's happened to the public here. And so that, to me, it's irrelevant whether we're the worst or not. This is where we are. This is our turf. God has entrusted this land
us,
our God, Yahweh. We this is where we're responsible for, to love our families, to love our neighbors, etc. And this is where we have to take a stand. And I really believe that. And I think you have to be a man and woman of integrity and to speak out. You know, I shout sometimes like I just did. I apologize. But I get so passionate about it because it bothers me. They can't exist if we speak out. And we got to have holy guts, as you call it.
Holy
guts.
Where is your column?
It's in all the East Bay
East
newspapers,
East Bay.
And
yeah.
Then all the
online.
Valley Breeze papers.
Yeah.
It's online,
okay.
Yeah. You can do the Valley Breeze.
I read your column every week.
Me too.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
I will start.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure being with you.